the section title is vector spaces and subspaces. We talked about subspaces just very briefly last time. So this was an example that we stopped on last time with vector space. So functions that take an input from x and they get an output from a real number. So if I take the sum of all of these functions, this forms a vector space. So what's the vector addition? Vector addition of my series f and g are two functions in this set. G. This is simply f of x plus g of x. subspaces. So the straightforward definition of a vector subspace is a subset of a vector space. First of all, remember that a vector space is itself a set. So a subset of that set, we would first take a subset of that and then make sure that it satisfies the property of the vector space. So this is a subset of a vector space that is itself also a vector space. Now, there's some things that are implicit in this that I should make clear. With the same vector populations. So when we go from the whole vector space to the subspace, we're still using the same definition for addition and scale. Before I get to the book talks first about three properties that a subset has to satisfy in order to know that it's a lot of the structure gets carried over because of the fact that we're using the same vector operation. So we know addition is defined because addition is defined in the bigger space. So it's also defined in the smaller space, which assumes the same addition. We have to make sure that the addition still lands inside the same subset. Let's look at an example first so that it's clear what we mean by this. I'm going to skip to an example. Okay, so let's say our factor in space. Try to find a subset of R3 that is also a vector space. Here's a possible example. So we're going to take the set of all of the vectors of the form A, B, 0. These are vectors in R3. It's a list of three numbers. The first two are arbitrary and the last one is a zero. Okay. That's the only thing I'm saying in this definition. And what I would say is this is a subset of R3. All of these things exist inside of R3. They're inside that set. And the addition, subtraction, scale, multiplication will all be defined in the same way that they were defined in R3. So we want to figure out if this is a vector space. Well, we have to see. We take two examples of things from this. Let's say A1, B1, 0, plus A2, B2, 0. Well, by continuous addition, we get A1 plus A2. So based on that, we know that this set is closed under addition, right? It has the closure property. Now, it's commutative because the addition, you else do we need to check? Scalar multiplication. Scalar multiplication works the same way. It's associative, it's distributive. All of those properties work. We just need to make sure that multiplication by scalars still remains a fraction. The reason that this one still remains inside here is because if you add two real numbers, you get another real number. The closure under addition follows from the closure under addition to the real numbers. Two real numbers added together to the real numbers. Now we want to see if scalar multiplication lands inside this set. So we can see a 0, and we know how scalar multiplication is defined because it's defined in the same way. Instead of putting a 0 here, we have a 1. Now, this is a subset also, right? It's a subset of R3. A, B, 1. These are lists of three real numbers, and these are definitely inside R3. It's a subset, and it's a proper subset, actually. It's not the whole thing. Okay, is this a subspace? Says no. With strong conviction, does anyone else have strong conviction? Is this a subspace? It's not a subspace.
Just for the first example, if you add two, where the third is one.
This is not. So this two. It's not inside here, so this subset is not close under addition. Zero factor also does not belong to Z. And scalar multiples, well, depending on what the scalar is. Close to the original example, but different. Okay, now two trivial examples. Example. Let's let the vector space. Which one should we start off with? This brings up an important point in the language that we're using, because this is mathematics. Our language has to be precise. We have to have a precise meaning. When we say that a subset, when we say it has to be a subset, we don't necessarily mean this to be a proper subset. All we mean is that everything that's in this set has to also be considered. actually satisfies a lot of our rules, too. All right off the bat, the sum of any two things in the empty set is also in the empty set because there's nothing to add. So it's true of everything in the empty set because there's nothing in it. Every scalar multiple is also in there. If I take any two things in here and I add them, I can add them in the other order, so it's definitely commutative. Right? This all sounds like cheating. It seems like I'm cheating here. Like I'm not saying anything.
That's true.
So is this a subspace? Why not? And why does it have to have the density specifically? Exactly. It didn't satisfy this bit right here. Well, actually, it did. So, the answer is no. Every vector space contains at least not a subspace. So let's change it a little bit. Try to use the eraser so I don't have to wipe things out without any class. And the answer is completely covered with chalk. Okay. Now every vector space has a zero vector. So this is a subspace of any vector space, right? We take the zero vector out, and that's it. That's all we have. Is this a subspace? Andrew says yes, but I'm not going to let him tell me more. Also, not Jay, someone else has to tell me. I'm like, disqualified, Dave, but what's up? Did you get lost? Someone else. Is this a subspace? Does it have enough stuff? Does it not have too little space stuff, and does it not have too much stuff? I don't know your name.
Clayton.
Clayton, what do you think?
I think yes.
Can you tell me why? That's maybe an unfair question because it's a long answer. We know 0 plus 0 is 0, so it doesn't matter which order. Space. So whichever vector space this came from, 0 plus 0 is going to be equal to 0. So specifically, it's going to be commutative because 0 plus 0 and 0 plus 0 are the same group. 0 plus 0 plus 0, grouped here, is going to be the same thing. It's going to satisfy all of the axioms of a group. And this is probably a good point for us to look at what we'll call subspace. Not what the book calls it, but it's a good name for it. So, in each of these cases, when we were looking at subspace, we looked at whether or not it satisfied all the rules of a group. Well, first of all, it had to be a subset. None of these were not subsets. Let's do a stupid example. Let's go back to our example right here and ask if this thing is a subspace. What's the answer?
This is not a dumb example.
This column vector only has two things in it. Is this a subspace of R3? Yeah, it's not even.
It's not even
in R3, yeah, exactly. It's not even a subspace. I mean, it's not even a subset of R3, so it can't be a subspace. So that's a good counterexample for us to think about. In order for it to be a subspace, it has to be, let's say, is it a subspace? So the subspace criteria.
this off. So let's suppose we saw in all these examples we didn't have to check everything, right? We didn't have to check commutativity, I should look that up, associativity, all of the other ones. We didn't have to check those because they were the consequences of using the same factor operations. Addition is still going to be commutative because, well, it was commutative already. It's the same addition. So we can reduce by a lot the things that we need to check in order for it to be a subset. Zero vector is in our subset. So it has to at least have a zero vector. Every vector has to have a zero vector. Next. Scalars, which we're always saying is R. Keeping in the back of our minds, we can always replace this R with those complex numbers or some other field. Then we do the scalar multiplication and we end up inside the same subset. So we can probably work some examples. So you remember this was a set of all, I'm just going to write it in English instead of symbols. All polynomials with coefficients from our field, whatever the field is. So this was an example we saw before. We saw that when we add two of these things together, the sum of two polynomials is still a polynomial. And if it's got a degree at most n, then the degree is never going to go up. It might possibly go down, but it will never, the degree of the largest of the two degrees, the result will never be higher. It can be the same or it can be lower. So our addition always lands in here, and scalar multiplication doesn't change the degree at all, so it's still staying in here. And then because we set the degree of the zero polynomial, which is the one where all the coefficients are zero, we gave it this convention that it was equal to negative infinity. So the zero polynomial is n, pn, no matter what n is. So it has all of these. The addition, scalar multiplication, distributivity, and all of the other things that a vector space has to have. These all follow from the same properties in R, because we end up just doing them on the coefficients. Right? Thumbs up? Okay. Just checking. Alright, so let's look at another example that's related. Simply the set of all polynomials. No
limitation on the degree. They could have any degree that we want, but whenever we pick one element out of this set and we look at its degree, the degree will be some finite number, right? It could be 2, and it would be quadratic. It could be 5, and it would be a quintic. It would be a 10, and I don't think we give those names. It could be a million. It doesn't matter. So all polynomials. So this satisfies all the rules of a vector space. You know, we add 2 polynomials, we get another polynomial. We do a scalar multiple of a polynomial, we get another polynomial. And what else do we keep this here? A polynomial still over there. Anything else I need to say? All of the other properties follow from the fact that the coefficients are real numbers, and those properties are properties of the real numbers as well. Here's the example. An, polynomials of most degree n, is a subset of p, right? They're polynomials of most degree n, so they're polynomials a fortiori. And now we want to see, is this a subspace? Well, we could use this as an example to check our subspace criteria. But in fact, we already knew that Pn was a vector space, right? We had already looked at this previously. So in fact, in this case, we don't need to check anything, but we could very quickly. We said that 0 is a polynomial at most degree n. Close under addition, we already checked that. Close under scalar multiplication, we already checked that. Okay. Our due diligence is done. But we could have just said we already knew this was a vector space. It's a subset of this, and it uses the exact same addition and scalar multiplication that we use in the bigger space of polynomials. So this is another good example of a subspace. Now, polynomials are functions. When we say polynomials, we usually mean polynomials of just one variable. So these are functions from reals to reals. Right? Lean this way, and I don't need to make eye contact with this side. These are functions from reals to reals, and so they are an example of this thing. And in this thing, we look at, well, the input can be any real number, so these are, we can do this. This is inside the real value functions with a real input. And another subspace. Going from here to here, we restricted what kind of functions, and we still got a vector space. Going from here to here, we restricted what kind of functions even more. Right? We restricted from all functions to polynomials, and then from polynomials to special kinds of polynomials. But in each case, this shrinking gave us a smaller vector space inside the bigger vector space. So we could shrink all the way down, we could shrink further. Let's say all the way down. The reals, which we can think of as just polynomials. Maybe I'm being a little loose by saying these two things are equal, right? They have different types of the objects inside them, but that didn't make sense. Okay. It still doesn't make sense. 0. That's what I'm thinking. Okay. So these are just constants. So now these are just reals. So this is also, remember, just a field itself is a vector space over itself. And so we can say this, and then finally we can go all the way down. The smallest possible vector space, which is the vector space that just contains 0. So we've shrunk our vector space down and down and down. Are there any questions about this? It's fascinating. Let's go from this example right here and look at examples that we can get.
still replace borrow in the field. When we do the check the rules, all of the rules will follow from the base field. So if we replace it with complex numbers, for example, it would still work. So if x is some set and we look at the real value functions on x, now we can say f sub y is a vector space also is f sub y a subspace. Let's go a little further and say if the null is a prime subset. Can we say that Fy is a subspace of Fx? Start off with the first part of the criteria. We made some assumptions at the beginning. So first off, we have to say is sub set y subset. So if I take something that's defined on y, it's also defined on x. The function form. Somewhere on the real line, right? The input will be something inside our log of x. The output will be somewhere on the real line. Let's say it's a negative number. Now, y is a subset, so let's say it's this smoother block. It's totally inside x. So if I have a function that's defined on y, say that I also have a function that's defined on x. It's defined right here. Do we necessarily know what it is over here? The function also takes something from here to here. We know what it does to y. This function, we know what it does to everything. Necessarily know what it does to things. In all
since the function is defined everywhere on X, what we end up with is possibly, we could have this set right here being something that's actually larger than this set right here. Because if we know what the function is on X, then we know what it is on Y too. So this thing over here should be a function over here also. So that the order of these things actually gets reversed. So now let's ask a question. Is f of x a subspace of f of y? We do have to take a little bit of a leap to say that anything that's a function that's defined from x to the reals is also a function that's defined from y to the reals. Because we're throwing away all of this stuff, all of this piece of information. So it's like something over here has too much information to be something. But we're saying that we're just ignoring that extra stuff. This is not an example result, by the way. So if we have a function that belongs to fx, then we can sort of say we have a function that belongs to fy as well. But just say it's the function that you get if you just ignore the part where it says what does it do outside of y. So that's a little bit of a leap. But let's say that that's okay. So we can say that this is a subset. So now we just have to check this. Yes?
What's the definition of a proper subset?
A proper subset is a subset. Something is in the subset, then it has to be in the bigger set. And if that's true for everything, if you can say that for everything in A, then it's also B that is a subset. A proper subset means that there exists an X in B, but it's not in A. I'm using a running example. So there's something in B that isn't in A. Everything that's in A is in B. Well, this is a problem. Proper subset has this additional thing. If there's something in B that isn't in A, that's what makes it a proper subset. Proper, I think, just means sort of like it fits with our English use of the word subset. When we say subset in everyday language, we mean something that's smaller. We mean a smaller collection. But the precise mathematical definition of a subset is so useful to include the cases where the subset and a set is a subset of itself that we just include that as well.
So, on this third question,
in this case, this question doesn't come down to what the actual functions are.
Right.
What you're talking about is we're restricting what the functions are. these two functions have two different types. So it's difficult for us to say one is equal to the other. We had to make a bit of a leap to say that they were equal by saying one of these things can be one of these things with just all of the extra information thrown away. Right? When we look at a function, let's say, sort of be considered the same thing, right? That's the kind of questions that I'm talking about when I talk about these, whether one is a subset of the other. The example that we had with replacing one, or making one of the entries in a vector only be zero, is kind of a different type of thing. Okay. So, hopefully we're all on the same page about what the thing is that I'm talking about right here. But now we can ask the question, well, if we've decided that it is a subset, we have to talk about whether or not it's a subset. We don't have to reference the class, we don't have to. So what does it have to satisfy? A zero vector has to be in there. In the case of real-value functions, what is the zero vector? What function works as the zero vector? How would I get that function? Well, it just the output is zero, right? So let's take any input from x. This is something inside this space, right? It had to be in order for this to be a vector space. That's right, last class we ended before I actually showed this was a vector space. It's in the board. So, this is in the vector space, and if we go to this subset, so we look at functions, we go from functions that are defined on all of them. That are defined everywhere on Y. When we look at the smaller space of functions that are defined on all of X, well, the zero is still there too. Okay, addition. We have to show that addition is defined. Well, we get that addition and scale multiplication are defined just based on the fact that they were defined. Like I spent a lot of time.